Good afternoon, everyone. Respected senior professor and director of Moniram Dhawan School of Management, Krishnakanta Hendrik State Open University, Professor Nipendra Narayan Sharma sir, respected Dean Academic in Charge, Professor Bipul Das, Dean Study Center in Charge, Professor Pranab Soikia, Finance Officer of the University, Sri Kamaleshwar Kolita. Today's speaker, Sri Manas Pratim Sharma, esteemed faculty members, officials of this university, and all the learners of the university participated in this program. It is my honor to welcome you all present in this online program for celebration of National Space Day organized by the GPD School of Interdisciplinary and Vocational Studies of the university. We all know that the spacecraft Chandrayaan 3 was launched on July 14, 2023 from the Satish Dhawan Space Center in Sriharikota, Andhra Pradesh. And after traveling 40 days, this spacecraft successfully soft landed on the moon on August 23, that is today, exactly 1 year ago. I still remember that our university arranged for us to watch the auspicious moment of landing of the spacecraft, and many of us enjoyed it together on this day. To honor the successful launch of Chandrayaan 3, the Government of India has officially declared 23rd August as National Space Day. Today, all over the country celebrating the first National Space Day with the primary goal of engaging and inspiring the youths of the country towards space technology and its applications. The theme of this year is Touching Lives While Touching the Moon, India's Space Saga. The Chandrayaan landing makes India the fourth country to achieve a successful moon landing near the moon's south pole. So now, may I request Professor Nipendra Narayan Sharma sir to kindly deliver the inaugural speech of this program.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Antara Mohan Tabura. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Distinguished speaker of this session, Dr. Manas Pratim Sharma of Guwahati Planetarium, esteemed colleagues of the university and the learners and other guests present in this online meeting. We all have assembled here for this online meeting to celebrate for the first time the National Space Day. As Dr. Antara Mohan Tabura has already stated, the importance of the day, and we can vividly recall that precious moment. And in fact, possibly this is an institutional arrangement to celebrate the kind of achievement that we have been able to make in terms of our space journey. And today, the day is being celebrated with a very interesting theme. The theme is Touching Lives While Touching the Moon, and India's Space Saga. So in this regard, we are indeed very fortunate that a resource person from Guwahati Planetarium, Dr. Manas Pratim Sharma, is here in our midst. Aru ei dintu jitu tatpurya gotei guruttakini ami upolabdhi korisu aru nishchoy tehete amak aji eta sundor lecture re amar ataike upokrito korib. And wish all the best for the successful conduct of the next time. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable speech. Before introducing today's speaker, I request you all to kindly switch on your videos, your camera, to take a photograph. So I request all the participants kindly switch on your camera. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Sri Manoj Protim Sharma, Project Associate, Guwahati Planetarium, Assam. Manoj Protim Sharma associated with Guwahati Planetarium since the last 25 years, conducting various scientific and astronomical activities of the planetarium and many other organizations of the Northeastern region, such as holding the office secretary of Pragjyotish Amateur Astronomers Association, Guwahati. He is also associated as life member of Assam Science Society, Assam Academy of Mathematics, Society for Chemical Education, Guwahati University, Astronomy and Space Science Association, Arunyak, etc. He is the founder secretary of the International Science Educators and Communicators Forum, as well as a member in the board of directors of the Astronautical Society of India, ISRO, GOVT of India. I welcome Sri Sharma again to this program and request him to kindly deliver his lecture. Over to you.
Thank you, Sri, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes.
It's fine, no? Okay. So I'll directly go to my presentation because it's already late. So definitely it's already, you introduced everything about today's significance and why we are celebrating the day particularly. So I would like to introduce about the saga of India's exploration of the moon, about just the story I'll share with you with this presentation. So I'll tell about from the beginning of the story actually. So I'll try to start my talk from this particular picture. It was published in the India Today magazine. And it's about this person actually who was considered as the father of Indian space program, Dr. Vikram Ambalal Sarabhai. So he is considered as the father of Indian space program, that all that happening in India actually, particularly in the field of space. So he is the pioneer. And accompanying him, definitely we can ignore Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam and many other people like that. But he is considered as Hello. Hello.
Hi.
Apuni khuna pai asane baro?
Audible hoy ase.
Okay. So I'll just read about his effort helped to establish the ISRO and set up IIM also and Physical Research Laboratory in Ahmedabad. So many things and involved in the first launch of the rocket from Tiruvananthapuram. He was awarded Padma Bhushan in 1966 also, and after his death, Padma Vibhushan in 1972. So this is the organization who is doing all these things for us, for the people of India. And this is the ISRO, Indian Space Research Organization. So this is a space agency, and it was like initially ISRO was formed like a committee actually, not ISRO like an organization like this. So it was a story in 1962 with the effort of these people like Dr. Vikram Sarabhai that ISRO initiated like a national committee for space research, and by government of India. And it was envisioned by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, as I told. And later on, actually, ISRO was formed on 15th of August, 1969. So just after the first lunar landing of Neil Armstrong and Edwin Aldrin, just after that landing, just a few days after. So it was on 15th August. So 15th August is, we may consider as the birthday for actually the ISRO. And so that's all. So going to the next slide, it's showing that the prime objective of ISRO is to develop an application space technology. Actually, that is the prime objective of to leaving the Earth and reach out the orbit and reach out to the other bodies, other celestial bodies. That is the main thing. And besides using the space technology, it will help us doing the communication, then television broadcasting initially, and meteorological services. Because initially we didn't plan for landing on the moon. It was started with basically a communication satellite like Aryabhatta. So initially it started like this, just putting a satellite, because we first tried launching a rocket, and then we tried to put it in the orbit, in a stable orbit around the Earth. So we get we can use that technology, because if we put some spacecraft, or probably some spacecraft is just a machine actually, it's kind of a, so which can receive data and which can telecast the data and broadcast the data. That is the thing. So initially we use for the communication, basically that telephony communication or television, all these things, and meteorological services also for the mineralogical studies, whatever is available on the ground, all these things, and monitoring also. And later on, it went to the defense part also, and we have defense satellites for monitoring the other countries doing some like launching missiles and all these things, and spy satellites also. So we have developed two satellite vehicles to put the satellite in a particular orbit around the Earth. So Israel developed one is GSLV, other is GSLV. Like two vehicles, one is smaller one and other was the larger one. The PSLV, Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, and GSLV, Geostationary Satellite Launch Vehicle. So Polar Satellite is like a low Earth orbit actually. So whenever we would like to put some satellite in a low Earth orbit, basically for navigation purpose and basically for our military purpose and all these things actually, low Earth orbit. So that goes to the PSLV. But when we go for our communication satellite, it goes to the GSLV, Geostationary Satellite Launch Vehicle. So the distance is very much higher. So like PSLV, the satellite, it brings around 400, 500 kilometers above the Earth surface, or maybe 1,000 kilometers. But for GSLV, it goes to the geostationary orbit. That's the around 35,000 kilometers. So it and the advantage is like that. When we put it in the geostationary orbit, as you know, that it will be in the same position above the Earth's surface. It looks, we can see same position, because it synchronizes with the Earth's rotation. It synchronizes with the Earth's rotation. So rotation period of a geostationary satellite is 24 hours.
Sorry for interruption.
Yes, sir.
Are you moving your slides? Actually, slide data move one.
Just a minute.
Pratham slide konote ase tar mane.
Is it coming?
No.
Can you see now?
No, we are seeing the only first slide.
Okay. So we have different ISRO centers. Okay. So I am telling about that geostationary and PSLV, PSLV and GSLV thing. So I couldn't arrange few photographs actually due to the hurry up. But still, I am just telling that PSLV is Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle and GSLV is Geostationary Satellite Launch Vehicle. So these are the vehicles we have to put. We need to put the satellite in the orbit. And one is the low Earth orbit, other is the high Earth orbit, like the geostationary particularly. So whenever we put a satellite in the geostationary orbit, that is for our communication, 24 hours. Communication without any interference. Like a continuous communication. So for continuous communication, we have to put a satellite fixed at above the Earth's surface. So if we'd like to put a satellite fixed from the above an Earth's surface, like fixed above India, so we have to synchronize the rotation of the particular satellite. So it's Earth. India is, if we think like, we are also revolving around Earth. Earth is revolving, but we are sitting on a chair. So we are also revolving around Earth in 24 hours. So if we put a satellite on space that synchronized with 24 hours, it will be like on the same position for us. So that is the geostationary orbit. Okay. So these are two the launch vehicles. These are few ISRO centers, as you can see. These are the first one is your probably this ISRO headquarters in Bangalore. This is satellite center. This is also in Bangalore. And this is the center where the satellites are assembled, actually. So actually, my kotha already kolu. My basically Bidhuliya nokolu. Parvali kotha kini kwai hol. Jai amar Vikram Sarabhai, father of India Space Program. But a particular sobikon, this is actually India Today Group published for particular occasion. গতিকে দিছ ইজ অল এবাউট হিম এণ্ড তাৰপিছত মই আপোনাৰ আহিছিলোঁ এবাউট দ্য ইছৰ' কেনেকৈ ইছৰ' ফৰ্ম হ'ল হাউ ইছৰ' ইজ ফৰ্ম হয়
শুনি আছোঁ
মোৰ ভইচটো ঠিকমতে পাই আছে নহয় পাই
আছোঁ এইটো ভাৰ্গৱ প্ৰাপ্তি কাইণ্ডলি মিউট কৰিছোঁ
হেল্ল'
হয় পাই আছোঁ
হয় হয় ঠিক আছে বাৰু গতিকে মই এইটো এইখিনি শ্লাইড বাৰু মই স্কিপ কৰি দিছোঁ। ইণ্ডিয়ান ইছৰোৰ যিটো বিগিনিং, ইটছ এ লাইক এ কমিটি, ইটছ ফৰ্ম লাইক এ কমিটি ইন 1962 এণ্ড দেন লেটাৰ অন ইটছ ফৰ্ম লাইক এন ইছৰো এন অৰ্গেনাইজেশ্যন ইন 1972, দেটছ 15 অগষ্ট। আৰু দেন উই টক এবাউট দ্য লঞ্চ ভেহিকলছ পাৰ্টিকুলাৰলি, ছ' দেট ইজ দ্য মষ্ট ইম্পৰ্টেণ্ট থিং টু পুট এ ছেটেলাইট ইন দ্য অৰ্বিট এণ্ড বিয়ণ্ড দ্য অৰ্বিট একচুৱেলি। So besides that, these are a few ISRO centers across India. Like this is the ISRO, the first left one is the ISRO headquarter in Bangalore. And this is particularly one very important center. This is URL satellite center, ISRO satellite center, actually ISRO satellite center. So this is the particular office where the satellites are assembled. Actually the satellites, different parts of the satellite are made in different laboratories across ISRO. So here you can see this is the LEOs, laser and electro optic system lab. So this is in Bangalore also, and another big lab is there in PRL, physical research laboratory, that is in Ahmedabad. So these are different laboratories. Like this is like whenever we talk about the cameras and all these optical devices that we put in our spacecraft, basically the cameras and all sensitive sensors even, and laser sensors particularly, these sensors are made in this particular center. This is LEO, laser and electro optic systems. So all the Chandrayaan cameras and Mangalyaan cameras, all these are made in this particular laboratory. Then all these parts are brought to this particular center. This is the assembling center actually for the satellites, the ISRO satellites. So all the particular instruments go individually to this ISRO satellite center where they are assembled, and the satellites is actually made out of that, actually putting all the stuff together. The satellites are completely assembled here, all the stuff like the cameras and all these sensors and everything, whatever is available, even the solar panels and everything. And they are packed from this particular thing, this ISRO satellite center. They are packed in big vehicles and they are sent to the launching site, that is the Sriharikota Satish Dhawan Space Center. Here you can see this is the Satish Dhawan Space Center. And from there, actually, we launch the satellite. We put it in the rocket, means what is the launch vehicle. This is the launch vehicle, actually. So this is the launch vehicle center. This is the satellite assembling center. These are various units. This is the ISRO headquarters. This is just a simple idea I'm telling about. And this is the satellite launch from Satish Dhawan Space Center. This is Sriharikota, Andhra Pradesh. So this is a GSLV, actually, vehicle, GSLV vehicle. And so this is a bigger version of PSLV, you can see. And it can bring the satellites to higher orbits. We can put a huge amount of fuels inside in comparison to the PSLV thing. And this is the particular chamber where we put the satellites. This is the particular chamber. And here there are different stages of rockets, actually. So we put different stages to maintain and stabilize the rocket engine, particularly to control its velocity. Because whenever we go the above Earth surface, we leaving the Earth surface, like we are going away, the gravity will be weaker than the surface actually. As far as we go, gravity will be weaker. So the force the rocket is going, actually that force, we have to control that force. And that's why we put different stages of rockets for different heights from the ground. So that is the main thing. So that's why we put stages of rockets, different stages. It's multi-stage rockets, rocket engines. So going to the next slide, this is the background of India's moon mission. So I'll be telling about this. So I told about the beginning of ISRO, Indian, the father of Indian space missions, and then the vehicle what we are using. And now I'd like to go particularly to the focusing on the India's moon mission, that all did happen and we are celebrating today actually. So that the Indian space program had begun with no intentions undertaking sophisticated initiative like human spaceflight and extraterrestrial missions during the initial days. Yeah, as I told that initially it was not planned like we are going to the moon actually, but it was only after ISRO developed its capabilities that the launch vehicle came, like PSLV and GSLV, all this. But we got with the advancement of technologies, we got the possibilities to go and reach beyond Earth orbit actually, and to reach out to the moon and even the Mars actually through Mangalyaan. So that is the thing. The technologies are getting advanced. We are developing more advanced vehicles, and we can bring our spacecraft, or even we can plan to bring humans also to moon and beyond and other planets actually, to the other planets. So that is the thing. But initially during the formation, it was not the idea. The idea of lunar scientific mission was first raised in 1999, actually, during a meeting of Indian Academy of Sciences. That was the particular meeting where the Indian Lunar Exploration Program was first discussed in that particular meeting. And then it was carried out by the Astronomical Society of India, ASI, in 2000. And the Robotic Exploration Program intended a precursor for until Indian astronauts land on the moon to carry out further future explorations. Okay. So this is like that first, our always the first target is the moon. So why are targeting the moon? Because moon is the firstly is the nearest one to us. And we are lucky enough that to get the moon actually so close, just a 4 lakh kilometer. Otherwise, if we go to Mars, that is like the closest distance to Mars maybe around 6-7 crore kilometers. So there is a vast distance between 6-7 crore kilometers and the 4 lakh kilometers. So this is very nearby actually. So we can think of putting a lunar base, and from lunar base, as moon has very less gravity than Earth, so coming out and getting into the moon is very easy actually compared to the Earth. It's very easy. So that is the one of the main things. So we need very less fuel to come out of the moon actually in comparison to the Earth. If we want to come out of the Earth and go beyond, so we need much more fuel and much. And one more big thing is that atmosphere. So that is another critical thing that we have to overcome, because that particular friction and forces with the atmosphere that causes much harm to the launching and even the landing of a spacecraft. And we need much calculation. Like landing a satellite on the Mars is very critical because Mars is atmosphere, but moon doesn't have atmosphere. So on Mars, if we have to send a spacecraft to land on the Mars, as the rovers are now roaming across Mars, NASA rovers particularly, you know. So that is a very difficult task. That is not very easy. Landing on the moon is very easy because gravity is less, definitely we know, but the atmosphere is, there is no atmosphere. So in the absence of atmosphere, it is very easy to land particularly because we have to imply specific aerodynamics for that particular atmosphere. Entering the atmosphere, we should know the thing, what the temperature, the pressure of the atmosphere, and the wind flow also in the atmosphere. This, all these things arise in the Mars landing thing, but during the moon landing, that is completely, we can avoid that thing actually. So going to the next slide, that the first mission actually, the Chandrayaan 1. So soon after the proposals by Indian Academy of Sciences in 1999, as I told, and the Astronomical Society of India in 2000, the Lunar Mission Task Force that was set up by ISRO actually. So this was the beginning of the all the lunar missions. So in 2000, year 2000 only, a National Lunar Mission Task Force, it was set up. Who was leading the all these things, scientists and technologists, they are accumulating from the all the ISRO centers and making the particular satellite to get it to the moon. And so the recommendations, what are the recommendations made during the meeting actually, and during by the task force actually? The Indian first one is the Indian moon mission assumes significance the context of the international scientific community considering several excitement missions in planetary explorations in the millennium. And that is the first one. The second one, and ISRO has the necessary expertise to develop and launch the moon mission with imaginative features, and it would be different from the past missions. Hence, ISRO should go ahead with the project approval and implementation. But that is the thing. So that is, these are all the official things they have to do to go for the mission particularly. And alongside, they have to develop the technology also particularly, and to get out to the moon with the PSLV rocket. Okay, so this is a very important line. So we are going to the moon. So this is one once asked by BBC, one BBC reporter in an interview in 2008, Dr. K. Kasturirangan, that he was then the ISRO chairman actually. So during the launch of Chandrayaan 1 in 2008. So, and he remarked that it is not whether we can afford it, like whether we can afford to go to the moon, but it is whether we can afford to ignore it. So that is the most important thing. So that is why we are going to the moon, because we can't ignore to reach to the moon actually. So that is the thing why we're making and targeting the moon, even if we are not so advanced like the United States or maybe the European countries, but we are targeting the space, not the moon, the space actually, because we can't ignore it. So this is about the Chandrayaan 1 details about that in 15th of August actually, that was the, then the Prime Minister was Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and he announced the cost around 350, he estimated the budget cost of around rupees 350 crore during that time. So in the November, then it was approved, Chandrayaan 1 project was approved, and then Abdul Kalam was the president of India at that time and visited ISRO office and advised there that orbiter alone would not suffice, actually. So that was an advice from the APC Abdul Kalam during that time, that he advised that we are not sending an orbiter. It's not be sufficient for us. We should touch the lunar soil. So how will you touch the lunar soil? During that time, we didn't have the technology to land on another planet. So definitely, if we don't land on some planet, we can put something from the orbit to the ground of the to the surface of the moon, so that at least we can say that we have touched the soil of the moon. So that is the concept first given by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And that was the beginning of the thing that moon impact probe. So we made a small cube-like thing, and putting the Indian flags and the ISRO maps are there, ISRO logos are there on above that metal thing. It's like a cuboid, actually. It's like a cuboid, metal cuboid. And so that is the moon impact probe. So what will they will do? That the Chandrayaan 1 orbiter will be there. It will be revolving around a lunar surface, around the moon. And so it will drop that particular thing on the lunar surface. And when it touches the lunar surface, the material will come out, because it will be like a collision. It will drop from the lunar orbit and it will hit the lunar surface at a very high speed. And when it hit the surface, definitely it will send the lunar soil into space, little bit, not so high, but little bit high. And the soil, and not the upper soil, the soil just beneath the surface, actually. Because it is hitting so much, it will create a crater on the lunar surface, a small crater on the lunar surface. And the materials out of that crater will come out into the lunar atmosphere. And by studying that atmosphere, that studying the spectrum of that particular material ejecting from the lunar surface, we can actually say what is exactly just beneath the lunar surface. And what ISRO has detected from the Chandrayaan, the most important thing was the water molecules. That is the most important thing. The moon impact probe hit the surface of the moon from its orbit with a very high speed. It created a small crater. And although we can't see water on the surface, but just beneath the surface, the materials ejected from the crater, that the ISRO observed the spectrum of the water molecules from the lunar surface. So that was the first direct evidence of water, actually, found on the moon. And and particularly that moon impact probe was also impacted on the near the South Pole only. So each and every time we are targeting from the Chandrayaan 1 only, we are targeting the South Pole only. That is the important thing. Why the South Pole only? Because during as we see on Earth also, on the lunar surface, if we consider the solar intensity means the heat and light coming out from the sun. As the moon doesn't have even atmosphere also, the atmospheric temperature on the moon is very high. So it's not like that, because the temperature is not so evenly distributed. Because in Earth, temperature is evenly distributed due to the atmosphere and the water bodies also, like the oceans. Okay. But in the moon, what happened? It's like a metal piece, like where the sun is falling, the sun rays are falling during the daytime. The temperature goes very high, around 100 degrees centigrade, or more than even. Or when it is night, the temperature is around minus 150 degrees. So this is a huge variation. So no atmosphere, because so temperature is not, he can absorb, the moon can absorb the temperature. So it immediately radiates the temperature in the sky, and the temperature drops down to minus 150 degrees when at night, and during the day, it's 100 degrees. So during the, but if you go to the polar region of the moon, like North Pole or South Pole, whatever, that solar intensity goes lower. And there are a few craters, like it's like a ball. So the sun's radiation is coming directly to the equator, actually. But if we consider like, or if we imagine like a ball on the, and put it some, a torch light around its equator. So if you see, if you kindly notice that near the poles, like the North or South Pole, whatever it may be, so it doesn't get direct sunlight. The sunlight is inclined there due to the angle, because it is a spherical body. And the craters, the moon is full of craters, you know. So the craters near the poles, North Pole or South Pole, basically, the bottom of the craters doesn't reach the sunlight, maybe from the billions of years, actually. Maybe for some 2-3 billion years, last 2-3 billion years, the bottom of that particular craters on the polar regions, the bottom doesn't get the sunlight or sun heat, anything. They're very cold, actually. Maybe minus 100 degree like that. But on the surface, it may be 60 degrees centigrade. If we go to the South Pole, if we stand on the South Pole, lunar South Pole, during the daytime, so temperature in the equator is around 100 degree, but in the pole, it's around 60 to 50 degree like that. It's almost half because the solar radiation is coming inclined, actually, in the pole, not falling directly overhead. But inside the craters is not receiving that particular sunlight for billions of years. So there are frozen water is there. Frozen water is there beneath that soil or inside that craters. Inside that craters, and water is the most important thing. Actually, we are targeting water each and every time. So water is the most important thing because whenever we go for some particular mission, so water is the most precious thing. Even whenever you see space vehicle, shuttle also that the US launches, the space shuttle, you got that rocket is launched, smoke is coming out, you know, whenever we launch a rocket, that is, smoke is coming out, and it's not the smoke, actually, it's the water vapor, actually. So we are integrating the hydrogen molecule and the water oxygen molecule together. We are burning, and the water vapor is formed, and out of that energy that rocket goes up. So from water we can make the fuel also for the rocket vehicles, and whatever, we can do everything with the water. That is the most important thing. So that's why we are targeting water each and every time. Even for any kind of settlement, in future settlement, human settlement, we need the water. So we should know how much is there actually in the moon, how much amount, and we have to for our settlement and for our future missions, putting a lunar base and going and reaching and or attempting to reach the other planets like Mars, because if we put a permanent lunar base over there, and we can go easily to the Mars. It's very easy because of the absence of atmosphere and the less gravity, the very less gravity. So that is the thing. And we can put, if we try to put a big telescope over there on the lunar surface, it is much it will be a much better view compared to the telescopes put on our Earth, actually. That's it. So these are all the possibilities we are trying to reach, actually, in probably near future. What we are doing we are targeting, and we are putting the moon impact probe only also in the South Polar region also. We are targeting each and every time the South Polar region. This is the moon impact probe. This is the moon impact probe. They are assembling the moon impact probe. Probably this is from the ISRO Satellite Center. This picture is from. These are the ISRO scientists and engineers working together, you can see. This is the moon impact probe. This is the first thing landed. This is the first Indian thing actually landed on the moon. And then the cost was, like I told, that 360 crore. That another thing was that if we'd like to go to space, we have to communicate with the spacecraft, because we are communicating, because earlier we are putting the satellites on the orbits around Earth. So Earth orbit is very close by, because if we put a low Earth orbit satellite in low Earth orbit, that is around 1,000 kilometers, maybe 500-400 kilometers, maybe 300 kilometers also in some time. But if we would like to reach, but for the geostationary satellite, it's 35,000 kilometers. But again, if we would like to reach to the moon, that communication is very deep, because that's why it's called deep space network or deep space communication, because that is, it goes to the deep space. So we are sending a signal to a distance 4 lakh kilometers, and we are collecting that data also, and we are sending the commands, all that up and down communications. Okay, that's a big distance. So for that big distance, the signal goes fainter for a particular satellite whenever it reaches the moon, actually, or whenever some object is revolving around moon or on the surface of the moon. So this is very difficult, actually, to communicate with that thing, unless and otherwise we send a very strong signal to that. And for putting a strong signal, we need a big antenna, big radio antenna, so that we can generate very high power signals. And that's why this is another project we have to set up. That is the Indian Deep Space Network. And that was the entire project cost rupees 360 crore, as is mentioned here. The project required India set up its deep space network. It's a deep space network. And the entire project cost 360 crore, rupees 360 crore. That is the another extra budget we have to put if we would like to reach the moon. If we'd like to reach the moon, that is the another budget we need, actually. And on 22nd October 2008, Chandrayaan-1 was finally launched, and from the PSLV rocket, yeah, the smaller one. And I'll show you later on how we launched that particular trajectory, actually. But because PSLV is a very small rocket and it the fuel capacity is very low, so it can't go actually directly, it can't go to the moon, actually. So we put some indirect techniques over there, and we put the satellite to the lunar orbit. That we'll see later on. But yeah, so this is about everything mapped. Everything has been mapped about the moon, lunar south pole, and after launching the MOU, so we dropped the MOU on 14th of November, actually, particularly 14th of November, that is 2008. So MIP, Moon Impact Probe, it landed. So the Chandrayaan-1 was launched on 22nd September, and the Impact Probe was dropped on the lunar surface on 14th of October. And then India became the fifth country to reach the surface of the moon, and first one to reach the lunar south pole, actually. So from in 2008 only, that we dropped the MIP on the, or the Moon Impact Probe on the south pole. And I'll skip this thing. That mission was intended to for actually 2 years only, but it lasted almost around lost contact within a year, actually. Okay, so officially ended the mission in 2009. So it's less than a year, actually. That is the first one, but that is the maiden mission to moon, a maiden successful mission for India, actually. And that is a big success also, because in a single attempt to reaching the moon, and that too with a PSLV rocket, a very small vehicle, it's actually a big credit for ISRO. And the second mission, as you know, that Chandrayaan-2, but Chandrayaan-2, actually it came with a little higher budget, because as we know, it put it had landing vehicle also, and the rover also inside the landing, the Vikram lander and the Pragyan rover inside that particular lander. So we in Chandrayaan-2, we planned with not orbiting the moon only, but now we'll land on the moon. That is the main target of the Chandrayaan-2 mission. So this is like demonstrating your technology, or not demonstrating, you can say it is a demonstration, always a demonstration whenever you do something new. But it is like acquiring the technology and the confidence also to extend your ideas or your reach to the space, actually. And so it has a little higher budget, and it was targeted to launch in 2012. And Abdul Kalam suggested for collaboration between India and United States for Chandrayaan-2. So he's the person. And then he suggested for some collaboration with ISRO and NASA, actually, and mission, and which could soft land near the South Pole and perform robotic penetrations into the surface to study more about the lunar water. So again, the water story is there. So however, an agreement, just a minute, yeah, sorry. However, an agreement has agreement had already been signed in 2007. That is the turning point, actually. In 2007, actually, before landing, before that advice came from Abdul Kalam, long before, in 2007 only, actually, we signed an agreement with ISRO and Roscosmos. So Roscosmos is the space agency of Russia, Russian Federation of Space Agency, for the second lunar mission under the Chandrayaan-2 project. So already we signed an agreement with Roscosmos to collaborate with during our Chandrayaan-2 mission. So that's why we couldn't approach NASA at that time. And then according to the agreement, the Russian collaboration, and what happened to the agreement, here it is written that according to the agreement, ISRO had the responsibility of launching, orbiting, and deployment of the Pragyan rover, while Russia's Roscosmos would provide the lander. So that is the thing. That is the turning point, actually. So Russia has to provide the lander, but Israel will do everything. Israel will do all other stuff, like launching of the rocket, make it to the lunar orbit, and deployment of Pragyan rover. And Pragyan rover will be made in India only. But the lander, because lander is a sophisticated thing, because to land on the moon automatically, computerized, I think. So you have to put the hardware and software such like that lander can find out the appropriate place where to land, control its own velocity while landing on the lunar soil, and all these things, calculating the velocity. And all these are automated, actually. We can't do it manually. So this thing, Russia already had the expertise long before. So already we signed an agreement also. And then Russia was handed over. The Roscosmos was actually handed over to make out the lander, that you make the lander for us and we'll do all other stuff. The design of the spacecraft by Israel was completed in 2009 only. And then payloads were finalized and launch was targeted in 2013. The project was then hit a roadblock. And that is the thing, roadblock when China deployed another lander, which was failed actually. This is Phobos Grunt mission. It has completely failed due to the, and the Phobos Grunt was the same kind of lander that Israel is acquiring from Russia, actually, the same kind of lander. So this lander was actually crash landed on the lunar soil. So so that's why actually Russia then proposed a few changes which required Israel to decrease mass of its rover due to increase in the mass of the lander, actually. So then that is the problem. So Russia told us to reduce the, because we are developing the rover. Two things are there. One is lander, other is rover. So rover is developing by India. Russia was developing the lander, but the weight of the lander is higher. So Russia told that you reduce the weight of the rover so that we can have a controlled landing on the lunar surface. But a delayed timeline and the Russian request accept risk mean that India had to undertake entire project independently. And that was the turning point when India decided that, no, we have to decline that agreement. And we have to go for completely like indigenous project like this. And we have to develop the lander also. And that is the first time. And this is, we are planning all these things in a very short time, actually. Very short time. Huh. So do one thing. So what India did at the time, India planned to make its own lander, and he planned and play own lander, and that was the turning point why we failed, actually, because the making a lander for landing on the lunar surface within this short time is very crucial, actually, and that we couldn't finally achieve that perfection for landing on the moon. And finally, as you know, that it crashed on the lunar soil. It crashed on the lunar soil while attempting its landing that time, 2013. So that was a very sad story, actually, at that time. And but the important thing was that the Chandrayaan-2 lander, that orbiter, because it came with three parts. One is the Chandrayaan-2 orbiter, other is the Chandrayaan-2 lander, and the third one is Chandrayaan-2 rover. The lander and the rover went down to the lunar surface and it crashed, but the orbiter was still working in a very perfect condition, and it had very advanced cameras and sophisticated sensors and instruments which are still working on the lunar orbit, even now also. And that helped Israel to make a second lander, the second version of the lander. It's almost a copy of like that Chandrayaan-2 lander on the lander and rover. But the thing is that what we got an advantage here, actually. So advantage was like that. We already have a satellite there, like on orbiter there. The orbiter is Chandrayaan-2 orbiter. So while sending the Chandrayaan-3 spacecraft, we are not sending any orbiter. We are not sending any orbiter to the lunar orbit because we already had the orbiter of the Chandrayaan-2 mission. So we will use that orbiter only for our Chandrayaan-3 mission. And this time in Chandrayaan-3 last year, actually, we just sent the lander and the rover only. So that's why, as the orbiter is not there in the vehicle means the PSLV, So we can increase the mass of the lander and the rover also, because the mass of the orbiter is absent. So that is the thing in this mission, particularly in Chandrayaan-3 mission. We are synchronizing the technology with the Chandrayaan-2, and that Chandrayaan-2 rover will be acting for the Chandrayaan-3 mission. That same orbiter will be acting for the Chandrayaan-3 mission. So Chandrayaan-2 orbiter is already in the orbit. Chandrayaan-2 orbiter is already in the orbit. So on the ground, there is one working lander and rover, that is Chandrayaan-3, that is not Chandrayaan-2. So on the lunar surface at present, we have two landers actually from India, two landers and rovers inside that, two rovers and landers inside that. So one is from the earlier one from the Chandrayaan-2, which was already crashed that time, and Chandrayaan-3 was also there, which has a successful landing, successful soft landing. Yeah. So this is about this is the Vikram lander. This is inside the ISRO satellite center. Actually, you can see there. This is the satellite. This is the Vikram lander for the Chandrayaan-3 mission. And inside that, you can see the Pragyan rover is there inside this vehicle, inside this lander. So this, they will fit this thing in this, inside this rocket, inside this GSLV thing. This is how they put the satellites inside a vehicle. Actually, this is from the ISRO. This is from not ISRO satellite center. Sorry, this is from the Satish Dhawan Space Center. So this is made in ISRO satellite center. Actually, assembled in ISRO satellite center in Bangalore, and then it is sent to Sriharikota. So this is from Sriharikota, where they are putting this thing inside the rocket or inside the vehicle launch vehicle. So this is a picture from there. This is actually an artificial crater created by ISRO. In Karnataka, it was in some village in Chalakere in Karnataka. So and to that mimic the lunar surface, this crater is made by ISRO to make the lunar surface. Why? For testing the lander, for automatic landing of the lander. Yeah. So they have tested their lander on this over their particular crater. A few other things they also made, that the lander will be moving across this through its lander has like rocket boosters inside just on its backside, so it can push the rocket engine or the thrusters that are fixed with the lander, and they can mimic like. Lander is an automated thing. It is completely computerized with sensors, particularly, which senses the ground, whether it is smooth or rough, so where they can land. So they are just testing that whether that lander tests the land on this particular crater on it, or it can detect the crater, or it can avoid and it can go away a little far, which is safe with a little far away from the crater and land on the smooth surface. So that is the. These are few testings, actually. Several testings has been done. This is like a simple crater, it's shown here. So that is, we have to test our landing thing on Earth. So it was like what we do, actually. So this is about in 2018, the mission ISRO, yeah. It was faced its second delay, actually. So ISRO made design changes for the spacecraft. As I told that, we have increased the mass of the rover and lander also, because we are not sending this time the orbiter. So we can put some extra mass there as orbiter is absent. So yeah, skip this one also. So yeah, so during a landing test in 2019, the lander suffered minor injuries in two of its legs. Okay, so this is during the testing thing. So the final cost Chandrayaan-2 was 800 crore. The flight of Chandrayaan-2. Yeah, this is about Chandrayaan-2. 2019, it was launched in 19, and then it was the lunar surface. Yeah. It is okay. Third, I am coming to the third mission, the Chandrayaan-3, particularly. So as I told, Chandrayaan 2 months after the failure of Chandrayaan 2, the third mission was actually proposed, the Chandrayaan 3. That's immediately after the crash landing of that rover and the vehicle, that rover and that lander. So Chandrayaan 3 would be reattempted, the same thing, demonstrating the same technology to be attempted. So proposed a partnership with Japan, and that is it was 75 crore from the government, initial funding, Chandrayaan 3 project, for the propulsion module, lander and rover. And it was expected to launch by the year 2020, but actually it was delayed, but because of basically the COVID thing that happened that day, during that time. So the launch was planned for early 2021, was then delayed 2022 due to COVID pandemic in India. And then propulsion module was ready before the pandemic has begun testing, and following lander and rover was tested, and conducted pandemic delayed the project and pushed tentative launch date to third quarter of 2022. And then another few means failure has been reported during the testing, during the particular testing on the ground, the testing of the rover, the testing of the lander, and even the automated software also, because it is an automated thing completely. And India is doing this thing for the first time in indigenous. So finally, the launch was made like just 1 year ago. It landed in July, it was launched. And in May 2023, the spacecraft was final stage assembly payload, Seaver Satellite Center. Okay, in 14 July, it was launched, successful soft landing. It was launched and it landed on the lunar surface 23rd August, just a year ago. And Vikram landed on the lunar surface, and then Pragyan came out of the rover. So this is the simple thing. And so India only the third country to operate a robotic vehicle. So we achieved this thing also, the India only the third country to operate a rover, robotic vehicle, rover, on the moon after Soviet Union and China. So this is Vikram lander on the lunar surface. And this is the Pragyan rover coming out of the from the Pragyan lander. So this is the rover, this is the lander. And this photo is taken from the rover, actually. This photo is taken from the lander, the rover. A rover is around 100 meter away from this lander. So this is the lander with several instruments for testing the chemical composition of lunar surface, the atmospheric composition, then the seismic activities, and along with like a temperature on the ground and just beneath the soil, what is the temperature? All these things. So surface temperature is around 60 degrees centigrade at the time the landing was there. And the mission was planned for, and so this is the rover coming out, the Pragyan rover coming out of the Vikram lander. So this is the lander and this is the rover. So this is a very small six-wheel vehicle. And here you can see that this is the solar panel. This is a very important thing, actually. So why the solar panel is aligned like that? Because we are on the polar region. We are on the South Pole. So sun will be in the horizon, not overhead actually. Sun will always be in the horizon. So as the sun will always be in the horizon, so we have to put our solar panel like this, like on a vertical position, so that it reaches the maximum amount of sunlight, so that it can charge and its battery and do the operate its instruments. So that is the thing. The orientation of the solar panel is like vertical because it is landing on the polar region, South Pole. And you can see these craters, just from the small crater is there. These craters doesn't get light actually. Does when the bottom of the these craters doesn't receive light actually, maybe for the last billions of years. And that is the most important thing. If there are many possibilities, and we already have detected the Chandrayaan 2 orbiter is there on the orbit. It is orbiting the lunar surface. So from the lunar orbit. So from the orbit of the Chandrayaan 2 orbiter, we already detected the water reservoirs, actually, water reserves near the South Polar region, actually. So we detected the signature of water over there. And so that's why we are targeting. We are going to the ground and we are actually testing how much water is there and whatever. However, that during this time, that Pragyan and the rover and the Vikram lander didn't find direct signature of water from the soil, but we already detected from the orbiter, and it's confirmed detection. And this is showing how actually In what position actually did Chandrayaan 1, 2, and 3, all these things are there on the lunar surface. So we can go and find out. So in the here, this is an image from the South Pole, from just above the South Pole. And this is an image from the equator. And here you can see the position of the particular, this is one, this yellow one is the moon impact probe. This is the position of the moon impact probe. So this is at the farthest point, actually, the moon impact probe. It is exactly at the South Pole. And the second picture, this is just over, exactly at the South Pole, actually, the moon impact probe. And then Vikram lander, the sun Vikram lander, two Vikram landers and two program rovers are there, as I told. One is from the Chandrayaan 2, one is from the Chandrayaan 3. They are very close by. You can see the position over there, the two landers and rovers. So Vikram, the first lander and rover was crashed. That is completely damaged, actually. And the last one, the green one, actually, the Vikram program rover that landed last year, actually. It is standing there perfectly, but it is not working now because that mission was planned for 15 days. And that is a very important thing. Not even 15, it's 14 days, actually. So why is 14 days? The thing is that here you have to consider, like, we are putting a lander and a rover. So they will be standing on a particular position over the lunar surface. They are not roaming around. Although rover may roam around up to maybe 500 meters. So that is a very small distance, but although overall you can say that the rover and the lander will be at a fixed position over the lunar surface. So if we have to continue the mission, the primary thing is the power, and that is the exposure to the sunlight. That is the main thing. So if the lander is getting the sunlight, the solar panel will be charged and the lander can walk, because power is the main thing. We have the instruments, but we need the power also to walk out. And here is the problem actually arises. So what happens as the rover and the lander will be standing on a fixed position? So it is not like that the particular position of the moon will be getting the sunlight all the time. That is not possible because the moon is revolving. So that is the same thing. Earth is also revolving, moon is also revolving. So there will be days and nights. So where the rover has landed or the lander has landed, during the daytime they can walk, but during the night they can walk. They are not getting the sunlight. And here problem is that on Earth that is very fine because our night is only 10 hours or 12 hours night. But for the moon, the lunar rotation is very slow. It is very, very slow. And lunar rotation is actually around, for completing one rotation, is around 28 days. So like 14 days daytime, 14 days nighttime. So 12 hours nighttime is very small. The rover can sustain. But for this huge long 14 days of nighttime, the rover cannot sustain. And that too with that minus temperature during the nighttime. So battery will be completely going down. It will be completely going down. It can revive itself even if it is getting the sunlight again. So that is the main thing. The rotation of the moon is very slow. That is 14 days night and 14 days day. So we have to do our stuff during that time of 14 days. Day means Earth day, I'm telling about. So that is the 14 days daytime only. During that time only, we can operate our rovers and the lander. Then when the night will come, it will be around 14 days of night, 14 Earth days actually. So it is a very long night. So then what happened after that 14 days night is over, that long night is over, by the time the batteries has completely been settled, it can revive again actually. And due to that, actually, the Chandrayaan, that thing was, that lander and rover project was planned for only for 14 days on the ground. But the orbiter is getting the sunlight everywhere. It is revolving around the lunar surface. So it is getting sunlight always. And so we can continue with the orbiter for long, long, long time. And but there are some like more technologies we have to achieve here to save our future rovers and landers on the lunar surface. What China recently did. So we have to put some batteries, some heaters actually, heaters to warm the batteries during the night. Some heaters to warm the batteries. And those heaters will be run by radioactive materials, radioactive fuels. So some radioactive materials, we have to make some heater, and that heater will make these batteries, particularly the batteries, warm during that nighttime. And so the rover can sustain even after the long night on the lunar surface. So China already did that. So we have to achieve that technology, probably in our next missions, to sustain on the lunar surface for longer time, actually. So that is the thing where the mission was planned for 14 days. And this is the landing site, Chandrayaan 1, 2, and 3, I showed you. And this is the orbit and the trajectory of the Chandrayaan mission, how we sent all these things, actually. So all things depend upon the vehicle. So you have a smaller vehicle, like with a rickshaw, you can go for 1, 2, 3, 5 kilometers, or maybe 10 kilometers. But beyond 10 kilometers with a rickshaw, it's very hard. For greater distances, we need bigger vehicles and stronger vehicles to go out. So for like an auto or something, we can go a little bit more, like 50 or 100 kilometers. For beyond 100 kilometers, we'll opt for like a four-wheeler or something like that. So you need vehicle, you have to change the vehicle home as per your distance you are traveling, actually. So that's why in comparison to that, like if we go for like if we go in between Indian cities, we opt for basically the trains. We can opt for flight also, but the train is convenient more. But if we go beyond India, we have to take a flight. So we have to change the vehicle, actually. So that is the thing. So for United States and other advanced countries, they have much advanced vehicles, or even Russia also, Roscosmos. They have much advanced vehicles to bring out our satellite to longer distances in a very short time, very strong vehicles, actually, with much fuel capacity. And but our India, I told initially that we always have a very less budget. That is the problem. So we cannot go for very these costly technologies. We cannot afford. So with cheaper technologies like PSLV, small vehicles. So small vehicles, we can go to the moon, but with a different technology. So that is the simple technology what we are using. So we have like a rickshaw, but we are going very far. So it is like you can see these are the orbits of Chandrayaan. All Chandrayaan 1, 2, and 3, everything is same, only the same trajectory. But this is the earthbound maneuvers, means that we are putting the satellite initially in an earth orbit, and then we are extending the orbit. We are extending the orbit why we are extending the orbit, so that at a particular distance, the gravity between the earth and the moon almost equal. So if we can send the spacecraft to that particular point, because directly coming out of Earth is very difficult. We need much fuel, actually. So Earth's gravity is very high. So, but slowly, if we go out of that and we reach that particular point where the gravity between the two bodies are neutral, almost zero. So at particular point, we can push our thruster. So we can switch on our engines, rocket engines, a little bit, just to push it a little bit towards the moon. The moon will automatically capture it. So with very less fuel, actually, the moon will take it towards it, actually. So here, the simple thing is like that. We are launching the spacecraft through the vehicle rocket engine into the Earth orbit. Here you can see this is the Earth orbit. So we are putting the satellite initially here. And this is an elliptical orbit, you see. Initially, we put it in a circular orbit. So and gradually, what happens at a particular point, if we thrust a rocket for some time, because in orbit we do not need any rocket engine, so without any fuel the satellite can go on rotating around the Earth for years, so it doesn't have any time, actually. But if we increase the velocity of start the rocket engine for a fraction of a second, not fraction of a second, but a fraction of a minute, maybe so around 30 40 seconds or 50 seconds, so if we start the rocket engine to fire, so it will put the satellite in an elliptical orbit like this, because it is getting energy more. So like you'll be getting a higher kinetic energy. So higher kinetic energy means you are greater distance from the Earth. So lower is the potential energy. So this is the simple thing of balancing the kinetic and the potential energy. So at the ground, kinetic energy is zero, potential energy is maximum. We are reducing the potential energy, increasing the kinetic energy of the spacecraft. So it's like that. It is moving in the first orbit. Then whenever this spacecraft is moving in the first orbit, you see, the spacecraft will be fastest at this point. That is perigee. Perigee is the shortest distance. Apogee is the longest distance from a particular object revolving in an elliptical path. So this is the perigee. In the perigee, it reaches the maximum speed. And while it is reaching the maximum speed, will switch on the rocket engine for another few seconds, another 30 seconds or 40 seconds like that. It will again push it into a little higher orbit. So like that, we'll be pushing the satellite like that to higher and higher orbit, and some like this, okay, extending its orbit towards the moon. And at this orbit, this is called lunar transfer trajectory. Lunar transfer trajectory, this is a particular trajectory. It will not come to the Earth again, it will go to the lunar orbit. So we are transferring the satellite from the Earth-bound orbit to the moon-bound orbit. So here you can see, this is a particular time where we will fire the rocket engine once more so that the moon grabs it actually. So then it will come to the lunar orbit, but with a higher elliptical orbit, because it has now higher kinetic energy. So up to this point, we have increased the kinetic energy. When it reaches the moon, we'll decrease the kinetic energy. So we'll put some brake on the vehicle, on the rocket, on the spacecraft particularly. When you reduce the kinetic energy, we'll put a brake. So the moon will take it to closer to it. So then if we're reducing the kinetic energy, finally it will reach like a circular orbit around the moon. And then at some point we can land, we can go for the landing trajectory on the lunar surface. So this is the all the Chandrayaan, not one, Chandrayaan 2, for the landing Chandrayaan 2 and 3 only, and for the orbiter Chandrayaan 1 and 2. So two orbiters are there on the lunar surface from India. One is Chandrayaan 1, which is not now working actually, and the Chandrayaan 2 is still working, still communicating with us and sending pictures of the lunar surface, scanning the lunar surface, mapping the lunar surface. That is most important, because for automatic landing on the lunar surface, we need a proper complete ground scanning of the lunar surface, but so that we can scan the lunar surface and we can find out the place where it is safe, the lander can find out the safe place to land on the moon. So that's why that is most important. So initially we have to map the lunar surface before to land it, because our vehicle should be landing automatically. We can't land it manually actually, because we do not have such a big close-up picture of the lunar surface from Earth we can see. So that thing will be like the lunar map, the complete lunar 3D map. That is important, the complete lunar 3D map, which has been achieved from the Chandrayaan 2 orbiter. The complete map was being installed in the Chandrayaan 3 lander. So Chandrayaan 3 lander already has on its mind the lunar surface, a complete map of the lunar surface. So it can find out where it is safe and where it is not. So like that, it can get there automatically, just scanning the surface and find out the safest place, and just avoiding the craters and the hills and maybe the rocks and all these things. So this is the simple technology, what we are going with a cheaper cost actually. And it is definitely, it is taking a longer time, but with a very cheap cost, which is with what we can afford actually, the countries like us. So I'll end my talk here.
Sir, give a khudibo neki.
এইটো সিগনিফিকেন্স টো আছে ডেফিনেটলি, কাৰণ টাচিং লাইভ মানে কথাটো এইটোৱে বুজাইছে যে আমি ইমান টকা পইচা খৰচ কৰি যে আজি চন্দ্ৰলৈ গৈছোঁ, হোৱাট এভাৰ উই আৰ ইনভেষ্টিং টু মাছ মানি, চ' টেকনলজি যিটো আমি এচিভ কৰিছোঁ সেইটোৰ কাৰণে, আৰু আমাৰ যিটো ফিউচাৰ প্ৰস্পেক্ট আছে এইটো ক্ষেত্ৰত ফৰ আৱাৰ দ্য ফিউচাৰ অফ আৱাৰ নেশ্যন বা আৱাৰ আপকামিং জেনেৰেশ্যন, ডেট উই হেভ টু গাইড একচুৱেলি, বিকজ স্পেচ ইজ দ্য নেক্সট মানে হেৰি নেক্সট ফিউচাৰ, গতিকে আমাৰ ফিউচাৰটো স্পেচতে আছে, আৰ্থত আমি পৃথিৱীখনত বৰ বেছি দিনলৈ আমি থাকিব নোৱাৰিম বা থাকিব নোৱাৰিম বুলি মই নকওঁ, কিন্তু কথা হ'ল কি আমাৰ ৰিচোৰ্চবিলাক কমি আহিছে সকলো ধৰণৰ। আজি মুনলৈ গৈছোঁ, প্ৰথম কথা হ'ল আমি মুনত লুনাৰ ছয়ডত যিমানখিনি আমি কেমিকেল বা মিনাৰেলছ আমি ডিস্কভাৰ কৰিছোঁ, গতিকে সেই মিনাৰেলবিলাক যদি আমি কেতিয়াবা তাৰ পৰা আনিব পাৰোঁ, কাৰণ আৰ্থত আমি লাহে লাহে আমাৰ সকলো ৰিচোৰ্চ, আমাৰ যিখিনি ৰিজাৰ্ভ আছে লাহে লাহে কমি আহি আছে, গতিকে আমি যদি ইনফাইনাইটলি আগুৱাব খোজোঁ, আমি যদি অপেনলি চাব খোজোঁ, আৰ্থ ইজ এ ভেৰি লিমিটেড থিং, a very small planet in comparison to the gotike kotha tu hol ki je heitu touching life se hei bostu te prothom kotha hol je etue amar ebar etue take koise je amar youth khini encourage koribise আজি ধরক গভর্নমেন্টে যেটা ইনস্ট্রাকশন দিছে যে প্রত্যেক স্কুলতে প্রোগ্রাম লব দিছে এইটোর কারণে যাতে আমি যেটা আমার নেক্সট জেনারেশন কারণ আমি আমারখিনি করে আছো বা করছো অলরেডি বা আমার ধরক আমি আজি বিক্রম স্যার ভাই কথা কও বা আব্দুল কালামের কথা কও তেওঁলোকে নিজের করণীয়খিনি করে গেল এতিয়া আমিও আমার করণীয়খিনি করে আছো কিন্তু আমার করণীয়খিনির ভিতর আমার এইখিনি সুমাব লাগিব যে আমি নতুন প্রজন্মটুক আমি এই বস্তুবিলাক লগে উদ্বুদ্ধ করব লাগিব আমি বহু ধরনের জয়ন্তী পাতি থাকবো গোটেই বছরটা যিবিলাক জয়ন্তীৰ ভালেখিনিৰে বহুত ছিগনিফিকেন্স নাথাকে কিন্তু আমি মহাকাশ দিৱসটো এটা ইমান এটা যিটো আমাৰ ভৱিষ্যত আছে ক'বলৈ গ'লে গতিকে সেইটো আমি এটা নৰেন্দ্ৰ মোদী ডাঙৰীয়া সেইটোৱে কৈছে যে আমি এটা দিৱস হিচাপে যদি উদযাপন কৰিব পাৰোঁ সেইটো সদায় কাৰণে আমাক এটা যেনেকে 2 অক্টোবৰ দিনা আমি সদায় গান্ধীক এবাৰ হ'লেও মনত কৰোঁ বছৰটোত আমি হয়তো 365 দিনৰ সময় নাপাওঁ কিন্তু 2 অক্টোবৰ দিনা অন্ততঃ গান্ধীৰ ফটোখনলৈ চাই আমাৰ এবাৰ মনলৈ আহে যে এনেকুৱা এজন মানুহ আছেই কথাটো তেনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ যে এনকাৰেজ কৰা আৰু যিহেতু ভৱিষ্যত আমাৰ এইটোৱেই মহাকাশটোৱে আমাৰ ভৱিষ্যত আছে গতিকে আমি মহাকাশক এৰি কেতিয়াও চলিব নোৱাৰোঁ গতিকে সেইকাৰণে আমি যিমান সোনকালে মহাকাশলৈ যাবলৈ মেলিব পাৰোঁ সিমানেই আমি আগত থাকিম
আমি আমাৰ আজিৰ প্ৰগ্ৰামৰ একেবাৰে শেষৰ পৰ্যায়ত আহি উপনীত হৈছিলোঁ ভৱিষ্যতে আপোনাৰ পৰা আৰু কিছু কথা জানিব পাৰিম বুলি কি এক্টিভিটিজ হৈ আছে সেই বিষয়েও জানিব পাৰিম বুলি পেলাই আশা ৰাখিছোঁ আৰু এতিয়া আমাৰ GPD স্কুল অৱ ইণ্টাৰডিচিপ্লিনেৰী এণ্ড ভকেশ্যনেল ষ্টাডিজৰ সহকাৰী অধ্যাপক ডক্টৰ নৱাংকুৰ পাঠকক আজিৰ অনুষ্ঠানটোৰ সামৰণি মাৰিবলৈ অনুৰোধ কৰিছোঁ অভাৰ টু ইউ নৱাংকুৰ
থেংক ইউ ভেৰি মাছ চ' অন বিহাফ অফ দ্য গুৰুপ্ৰসাদ দাস স্কুল অফ ইণ্টাৰডিচিপ্লিনেৰী এণ্ড ভকেশ্যনেল ষ্টাডিজ ডক্টৰ নৱাংকুৰ পাঠক আই এম প্লিজ টু গিভ দ্য ফৰ্ট অফ থেংকছ ফাৰ্ষ্ট আই ৱান্ট টু থেংক আৱাৰ ইউনিভাৰ্চিটি অথৰিটিজ ফৰ দেয়াৰ কনষ্টেণ্ট ছাপৰ্ট এণ্ড গাইডেঞ্চ দে হেভ অলৱেজ ইনস্পায়াৰ্ড আছ এণ্ড এনকাৰেজ আছ টু অৰ্গেনাইজ দিচ ৱেবিনাৰ্ছ এণ্ড আদাৰ ইভেণ্টছ আই অলছ' ৱান্ট টু থেংক আৱাৰ ৰেচপেক্টেড ৰিচাৰ্চ পাৰ্চন মিষ্টাৰ মানস প্ৰতিম শৰ্মা for sharing his valuable thoughts and taking the time to talk about such an interesting topic. His presentation was truly refreshing and enlightening. I would like to thank all the participants and fellow faculty members who attended today's webinar. Your active participation made this event a great success. Lastly, I would thank the system analysts of the university for providing technical support and ensuring that this virtual talk runs smoothly. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.